Okay, so I am Charmel McMillan. This is season 3, episode 8 of It Is What It Is, How Men Think. This is my 49th show. And this, a little bit of background, 11 years ago, I created and produced a radio show called It Is What It Is, The Male Perspective on Love and Relationships. And I did so because at the onset of social media, sometimes questions will be asked exclusively to men, but inevitably women will be the first ones to chime in. And they wouldn't just chime in. They would edit, correct, even tell men that ain't how men think. So I decided to create a platform where men tell it like it is, uncut. So that's what we're doing tonight. I fast forward to 2020. I rebooted it as a Zoom show. This is not a woman bashing platform. It's definitely not a male bashing platform. It just is what it is every Tuesday, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard, 5 p.m. Pacific. So with that being said, let me introduce my guest. My first guest, I met him on Clubhouse. And so anybody who knows me knows I'm all about energy. I loved his consistent energy and the dialogue I would hear him speak about on Clubhouse. And so I decided to invite him in to be one of my guests tonight. And he's a managing partner of the expanding entity Infinity Music Entertainment, IME. And they are creating a whole new wave sound called Rhythm and Trap. His name is Loren Hooks, aka ThatDamnLo. How are you? Start video.
I'm doing pretty good. How you doing?
I'm good. Good to see you.
Yeah, I'm just chilling and relaxing, waiting to have a good conversation. And yeah,
it's going to be a good one.
I was dope too. So that's why I came on and had no problems. You know, it's like dope. So
appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And my next guest, I have known him a billion years, and he is signed to International Quantized Records. He's a recording artist. He's a former MCA recording artist. He's a songwriter, producer, also actor. He has appeared on The Wire, The Corner, Oz, Homicide, on Life on the Streets, as well as Runaway Bride with Paramount Films. He hails from Baltimore, Maryland. Richard Burton, how are you, love?
Hey, hey, Cheryl, what's happening? It is
how you
what
been?
It is.
Yes, how you been?
Yeah, I've been fine. How about you?
You family. I haven't seen you in a long time.
I know. I've been trying to stay alive.
Me too.
You know what I mean?
I'm remote as I don't know what right now.
Yeah, you know, you got to be careful.
Yeah, I travel for a living, but I've only been out of the house like maybe twice to see my bestie when he was in concert. I snuck up on him. But other than that, I've been in the house.
I'm about to go back overseas now. I don't have a choice. You know, I love my fans over there and they love me and I'm ready to go back.
Yeah, well, be safe and, you know, keep it moving. Do what you gotta do during this time. It's crazy. So let me introduce my last guest, definitely not least. I've known him for years and years. He's CEO of McCants Sports and Fitness LLC. He's also the founder of Finding Me Foundation, geared toward reducing delinquency through a young readers program. He's a former NFL wide receiver. He's played for the Washington Redskins. Washington football team or something now. Anyway, he has also played for the Philadelphia Eagles, Baltimore Ravens, Darnerien McCants. How are you, love?
I am well, and yourself?
I'm good. Good seeing you. I haven't seen any of my people in a long time, even before COVID.
Yeah, I'm a regular person now, so I keep it regular. Because I was about to say, you said my man going overseas. I was scared to go when I was working on my music. Like, I got invited. I was like, man, they're going to kill me if I go over there.
That's right. I never forgot you had a music career also. I have a music career also. I remember the football
you
stuff.
You brought me on the show. You brought me on a show, something, and I think you had something
original,
up in one
of
the radio
you on the original It Is What It Is almost a decade ago. Yes.
It's been a good minute.
Well, I am excited to have you guys. I'm glad you are here. I always start off with an icebreaker question. So I'm going to ask this. Is it since I got an athlete, I got someone who prefers to do their own stunts when they're in movies, and I got a record label exec. I don't know how that works, but anyway. My icebreaker question is it a blow to a man's ego to lose to a woman in a game or sporting activity? And should a woman let her man win just to save his ego?
Wow. Okay. Is it an order on what you're going to ask us?
No, it's round table. Y'all can jump in all night long.
I'd like to see my baby win. When I have a baby, you know what I mean? It's good to see your baby win.
Against
it's
you?
It's actually sexy in a way, you know?
Okay.
It's eternal, you know?
against you. Man, I'm dunking on my lady. She better not come in the car.
Yeah, because I was like, I'm a competitor. So it don't matter, like, what it is. I'm going to compete. I'm a little better now because I'm a little older, a little bit more chill. But definitely when I was younger, if we was hooping, shoot, like they said, there was no gender. If you play basketball, you stepped on the court. Hey. Yeah, you got to watch your head.
Yeah, you can't pick and choose when you want equal rights.
Right.
You said watch your head.
Yeah, you got to watch your head.
And so, Lo, you said you throwing elbows and everything. You doing flagrant fouls and everything.
I'm going to throw the elbows. You know, I'm just going to let her know. Okay. All right, there we go. And it's all good. We back to business. So, that's because she started talking too much stuff. You know, y'all start talking stuff when y'all start winning.
See, oh, yeah, they talk trash real fast. Yes, they do. So.
Yeah.
When they start bragging. You ain't say that on the court.
Exactly.
So let me ask this. I had this discussion last night, actually, on Clubhouse. We do a teaser room on Monday nights to get ready for tonight. And I asked, are alpha males extinct? Do you think alpha males are extinct?
Hell no.
Nah, we just older.
No. We're older lions. You know, when you're a younger lion, you're different. When you're an older lion, you're more chill, you're wiser, you're more cautious.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Now, if it's a true set it subject as an alpha male where, like, men are more aggressive, more assertive, more confident, I think that's always going to be in our culture because mm-hmm. that's the way you have to survive in our culture many times. Like, because if you soft, you know what I mean? We look at you kind of sideways, you know what I mean? Even though the new kids dress a little different, they still part of it, but it's just a little different than how we grew up because it was a little more rough. You know what I mean? We had a different environment than what they had.
What you thinking, Richard?
I'm listening right now, you know. I said it earlier, actually. You know, when you get older, it hits different. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You're a lot wiser. You're more cautious. So it may seem as though you're moving a little slower or whatever, but you're really thinking.
Okay. You know, so how do you guys define like alpha male? Because I said last night, for me as a woman, I think of it as a man who is a decision maker, who leads, protects, guides. I feel safe in the presence of alpha men, you know? So I don't really have a whole bunch of betas in my life. And I know a lot of men, but I don't have a lot of betas as friends and associates and everything else because I feel like I'm still calling the shots. I feel like I still got to be CEO and I don't want to be that in the presence of a man. Hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, hey, I get you.
From. Yeah.
You know, I could speak on that. You know what I mean? Like, I believe in, like I said, we have to be equal, but that makes us balanced. So you can still be your lion and I can be my lion. Doesn't mean I'm taking anything from you, but like you said, as a male, natural instinct for me is to protect. Like, I don't know why I do it. Sometimes I'd be like, man, what am I doing? And I just, like, my friends could call me up. I've had several domestic violent situations. They called me, you know what I mean? Hey, can you come get me? And I'm like, hey man, you know, just let her get her stuff and we just go about our business. You know what I mean? And I wanted no relationship with these females, but they knew they could call me to come help me get their stuff. And I was never challenged by none of the dudes.
No, you quiet.
It's like, I don't know, I'm big on just being who you are. If it happened to be alpha, you're alpha. If it's not, you're not. I mean, I just feel like if you concentrate on it, you're going to be out of pocket. So that's why.
Well, isn't it innate in some men? Not that they concentrate, not that they call themselves one. It's just an energy they exude, or no?
Yeah.
I mean, that's true. I mean, you can tell by how they live more so than what they say. You know, I think a man that's an alpha male is, because that can be anyone's definition, but I think a man that can hold his own, a man that's secure within himself. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you get to the point you're secure in you, I mean, like, you don't care what nobody think. You don't care what nobody say, like, this is who I am. And I get it. I understand it. My mm-hmm. faults, my, you know, all my good, my bad. That's what I think, you know.
And Char, you're also around a lot of people who have to be lions. You know what I mean? They have to be alphas because that's the only way to survive.
Right.
So, you know, we're technically all independent individuals who kind of run our own businesses because we ain't listening to nobody. You know what I mean? So it's like, dog, I don't care what you say. I'll work with you, but I'm not working for you. You know what I mean? So it's kind of the environment that you are in. Like if you're a beta in this environment, you're going to get ate up, you know, like even coming from, you know, the sports world. You know what I mean? It's like, it's sharks and piranhas. You got to learn how to swim. If you're a guppy, you get ate up.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to give you a good example. You know my history. You know, I traveled when I left, when I was 16, I left Baltimore. Mm-hmm. And I was with Muhammad Ali for years. So you got to understand, being around a man every single day. And I've seen him around people who I may have thought were bigger stars, but he had that alpha man. It was just the way he carried it. Mm-hmm. You don't have to say anything. It's just the way he carried it and his energy.
Right.
When he walked in the room. That energy has a lot. You know, the energy says a lot.
Yes.
That's right.
Energy, I think, is the most valuable part of having that alpha energy. You know what I mean? Or that alpha aura, if that makes sense. You know, like, love when I said last night when we were talking about it, I love when I'm, because I work a lot, you know, and I have three companies. So I'm always making decisions. I'm always traveling. I'm always doing this. But I love it when a man says, I got it. And I don't mean financially. I mean, take something off my plate. And I don't even have to know you moved it. I just know my plate is lighter. That is sexy as hell to me. That is alpha to me. You know what I mean? And if you say you got it and you got it, then I trust you.
Right, you know what I'm saying?
Say you got it and my plate's still heavy. You know what I mean? Now I'm thinking about three things instead of two. So that's what I see as alpha male. But let me ask this. Does the one that makes the most money in a relationship have the control?
I think that depends on the people. If they see money as a control factor, because like you said, now that's a controlling concept. So for men who make a lot of money, I got a trophy wife or I got somebody because she's beautiful or whatever. And I have the money. So she's going to do what I say do. Mm-hmm. But I think that depends on the people because I've had money and I'm like, money don't mean much to me. It doesn't exist. So it's like, all right, you know, I got to get money. I'm going to get money. But it's like, I'm not going to say to hold it over here. Well, I pay for this and I pay for that. And I pay for this. You should do that. No, I just don't feel that that works for me.
Now, the only problem with that, Char, is this. If you're in a situation where the woman makes more money, but yet you're still trying to be, as you say, the alpha male, you're going to handle everything. But at the end of the week, you're sitting there stressed out. But she ain't spent none of her money because you're trying to be this alpha male in old school. Because I'm old school. I believe it's just me. I know I don't mind paying all the bills. I mean, I would rather my woman take her money and put towards her looking beautiful or investing in. Now, here's the thing now. Now, if you want cable boxes in every room and all that kind of stuff, now we got to start talking about some stuff, you know. No, but I'm old school. I just believe still. But I think if the woman is making more and the man is the one that's giving the most, that could kind of be a problem.
Okay. Lo, you still nodding? What's up?
Well, I mean, it really depends, like you said, on that couple. Because, I mean, me, I like taking care of everything, but shoot, if I get some help, I'm not going to turn it away because it's just what it is. Need help sometimes. We in the corona. Yeah. We in the panorama right now. So, you know, things are slowed down. So it's like, if you ain't teamed up, y'all going to be alone anyway. So that's right. Believe a teamwork makes the dream work. So.
Okay. So I asked a little bit about, you know, are alpha males becoming extinct? But do you think that there's a targeted feminization of men that's happening in society?
Of course.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. They've been doing it for years.
Yeah, it's not nothing new. It's been going on for since I can remember. So
yeah, that ain't nothing new, especially the black
emasculation of the black man is always been on the case.
Yeah. And Shaw, it's local, it's state, it's federal, it's everywhere.
Yeah.
It's international. No, that's always been the thing because, like I said, we're the most dominant creatures on the planet, genetically, besides, you know, after the black woman. But for the most part, obviously, the reproduction part of it, That's where we come in. That's why, that's the fear. You know, and it's, I think it's innate in certain cultures that, like I said, when you see us, when I walk into the room at 6'4", 220, I demand your attention. I could be smiling, but you're going to look at me and like, who is that dude? And why does he look like that? You see what I'm saying? So my father was the same way and my son's going to be the same way. Whether our personalities match it or not, just our physical presence demands that. But so I have to feminize you so I'm not scared of you anymore. So long as I think of you as a woman or soft, because, you know, we think about homosexuals, you're soft. Then I no longer fear you. It's an innate fear that a lot of people have because what they know what we possibly can do. Like, I like to mess with people. I said, the reason we can't get into the government because they seen what we did in football and basketball.
And so I think, is it beyond, you know, guys, is it beyond sexuality though? You know, because I know working in this industry, there are some men, you know, because you brought up, you know, alternative lifestyles and things of that nature. I know being in this industry, there are some men that you would never guess are gay, you know what I mean? Or some women that you would never guess, you know? And so is it beyond that though? Rodney Perry said, I think a couple of weeks ago when he was on, that he thinks the breakdown of especially the Black family, you know, and removing of the male from the drugs to jail to feminization to whatever. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, those are the facts. Like, it's physical evidence for that. Yeah, it's definitely physical evidence to validate exactly what he's saying. Because the strongest bond is man, woman, child. That's the true trinity. Man, woman, child is the trinity. Because that's how we procreate. Because even in our worst situations, when we broke, when, you know, I'm out the hood, that's when I was probably the happiest. I ain't had nothing. I ain't had nothing to lose. You see what I'm saying? So the man, woman, and child, if I break that down, then now other cultures get to have our women. Other cultures raise our children. So then there's no more Black family. So that's easy to break them down. So now that Black man is by himself, who's going to help him?
Lo, you were going to say something?
Well, I was just going to say, I mean, my thinking, like, the biggest prisons in America are religion and tradition. So, I mean, that's my thought on it, because a lot of things that we hold to are traditional and they make no sense. So we got to start making sense of things now, as far as like interpersonal relationships with each other. It's got to make more sense now, not just because it's what everybody else did or what it was in the past or what it's been until now. We got to start making our own rules on certain things because a lot of it hasn't been working.
It ain't worked. Like, it ain't work. No, because only a small percentage of us that make it out.
Before I ask my next question, oh, go ahead, Lo.
No, I was gonna say, and a lot of things are designed to keep us at each other, talking at each other, and not to each other.
Combative.
Keep us, you know, yeah. A lot of it is designed for that, to keep us like on edge about everything, instead of just relaxing and really seeing what it is, so that we can work through it together. It's like, as long as I'm over better than you over here, and I'm better than you over here, then we're always going to be at odds.
You know, Sean, I'm sorry. I was just going to say, you know, the way I was brought up, you know, I just loved all people. You know, I had gay people in my family. When I was even too young to know what gay was, but I loved them to death. And if you mess with one of them, we all fight. And so when I grew up, I didn't grow up as to dislike this person because of that or that. But when it hit me was when I felt as a Black man, I was attacked. And I'm not going to say the place, but you know it. I was working in a place where I was really proud of. I didn't have a college education to get there, but because of my skill and my talent and relationships with people, somebody gave me an opportunity to put me into a certain place, right?
Right.
When that person left.
Right.
I know. And the new leadership came in, I felt under attack. I felt like if I wasn't like, girl, your makeup, beating your hair, fizz, you didn't want me around.
Right.
I grew up at a time where the Black woman was like auntie, or they loved us.
Right.
So then I saw something where it was like as if the sisters that were in positions of influence hated me. I'm their nephew. I'm their son. What happened? Whereas though now, because I don't fit into your clique, because I'm a man, because I want to go home to my wife. I want to do what I want to do. I ain't sleeping with none of y'all. I'm not partying with none of y'all. I love you all, but I got to be treated. And I see Black men, I'm telling you, you would be surprised to see the war that our Black men are going through mm-hmm. in different businesses, agencies, organizations, all because they just wanted to be a Black boy, a Black man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it's hell we fighting, you know? Yeah, and I love all people.
Mm-hmm. And I know exactly what you're talking about, and you were responsible for some of the major things, you know, that happened around the city and instrumenting certain platforms and things of that nature. And so your presence was perpetual for many years. But I also want to ask, because you hit on something, is there a masculization, if that's a word? Are women becoming more masculine, you know, in how they conduct themselves? And if yes, why?
I'm gonna chime in on that first, because we're Negro parents. We're trying to live in a European culture, and the white woman has a problem with her white man, and then they say, "Hey, sister, help us out," but they've never helped us out ever. Mm-hmm. So it's a battle between them. At one point in time, like you said, before the 70s, everybody kind of had a place. So like my man Richard said, he said, I was a man. A man is being responsible, not being, you know, slutting yourself out because every female that's around you is attractive and you're in that business. A man is being responsible, saying, hey, guess what? I love you and I'm gonna go home to my wife. You're fine as I don't know what, but I'm going home to my wife because I understand what a man is and my responsibilities. So mm-hmm. what ends up happening is we're taking on a lot of European traditions and cultures, and it has nothing to do with our culture. So our women are strong. Our mm-hmm. women will talk back. Our women, if making more money in some circumstances, will demean a man because I don't need you, because that's what has been taught traditionally, because a lot of times they've had to be by themselves. My mother grew up by themselves. You see what I'm saying? But the reality of it is, when you start talking about marriage and divorce, that didn't happen until the 70s when they mm-hmm. said, hey, take this check and get rid of your man. And then, of course, that's another tradition that started, because guess what those women became? They became toxic. I don't need a man. I don't want a man. And that's only in the Black culture. I've yet to find it in another culture. If it is, we don't deal with it, but I'm not looking to help any other culture but my own. But that's from my perspective, from what I've seen and I've studied myself. It's like we're taking on somebody else's problems that ain't got nothing to do with us, that don't love us, don't care nothing about us. And then, like I said, it plays that part. Hey, I don't need a man. And then obviously, you know, life imitates art.
Mm-hmm.
Can I say something just to piggyback on what you were saying, Cheryl? When we talk about masculinity, right? Here's something we don't think about. I see a lot of women who may go date a man, make that guy the stepdaddy or the boyfriend, put around your young, vulnerable son. And because your son don't play football, because your son don't like boxing, you hear the guy. And the guy, his masculinity is only based on the street. Only on perception,
mm-hmm.
the act of being hard. But you telling this little boy, you're a faggot, you gay, you this, because he's not interested in doing the things you think he should do. And I mm-hmm. see a lot of, I just see a lot of sisters, we need to protect your children from these men with these falsehoods, these perceptions of what masculinity is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, some people think being hard is masculine.
No, intelligence is actually masculine.
Yes.
Because if we talk about masculinity, you're talking about Martin Luther King, you're talking about Malcolm X, we're talking about Marcus Garvey. Those are intelligent men. If you're talking about a street hoodlum, I can't see the intelligence or the heart, because it's like, hey, I'm gonna do whatever it takes to kill myself or put myself in jail. I don't think that's intelligent, but what you're stating is would be toxic masculinity is what they're trying to say. And once again, that comes from out of the slave tradition mindset, mental slavery of trying to put these boys through stuff that has nothing to do with encouraging or progressing our culture. If we're not progressing our culture, what's our point?
Mm-hmm. Richard, you talked about feeling uncomfortable in a work environment where they're so-called strong women, you know, and I guess strong would be positional, not necessarily emotional maturity, you know, and right. spiritual intellect. But there's and Lo talked about a combativeness, and Darnerien hit on it, the combativeness and the struggle that has become perpetual between men and women, especially Black men and women. And someone said last night when we were talking about this, that some women, even if you give them the alpha male, even if you are the protector and the covering, they don't know how to receive it. And I said, because sometimes, you know, women are hurt and they are carrying things that they haven't healed from, they don't know how to heal from, and uncomfortable, being uncomfortable with being happy has become a standard. Not knowing how to, you know, be joyful in a relationship or appreciate kindness or love or respect has become the norm. So now you look at those men like something's wrong with them because you're used to being abused.
Yep.
Or mistreated. Oh, yeah. You know what I mean? You live in that dark space, so you don't know how to, you don't even see it. So you try to convince yourself and you're actually repelling people. You know, you say stuff like, I'm a strong Black woman. I don't need no man. I can do this by myself. I raised all these kids. I'm a mom and a daddy. I mean, you say stuff like that. You know what I mean? Yeah. Thoughts.
Y'all can go first.
I was about to say, hey, I can take lead. I mean, if y'all go, hey, I got a lot of papers now.
To me, I'll take lead on this. To me, the word strong woman is a redundant phrase because I'm like, if you who you are, your strength is going to show. You don't have to talk about your strength. It's going to be evident. So to say strong man, a strong woman, or this, real this, or it's just redundant to me. Just be who you are, and it's going to show up.
Don't have to state the obvious.
Yeah,
right. Absolutely. But remember, like I said, we're coming out of trauma, post-traumatic slave trauma. Like, people don't realize how close that is. When I told the kids that my grandfather was a sharecropper and my great-grandfather was a slave or enslaved, it's a difference. He was enslaved by some people, the McCants clan. And they like, what you mean, your great-great? And I'm like, no, I'm only three generations out of servitude. And my grandfather only had an eighth grade education. He started his life off as a sharecropper, which all we know is basically a person who was getting paid pennies, you know, to till land until he figured out some things on his own. So like you said, that whole concept of strong, you don't have to show you strong. If I have to tell you I'm something, I'm probably not it. If I got to tell you how much power I got, oh, do you know who I am? I'm Darnerien McCants. I played in the NFL. That's weak. That's why, like, when people introduce, they was like, why don't you say you play in the league? I'm like, for what? Turn the game on Sunday, you see me. If not, it ain't that big, it ain't that serious.
And that's true. So that's why I rarely will put or advertise something I'm doing. Just once in a while, you know, like some people post every day, and it's nothing wrong with that, because I don't know, I'm at a point in my life, I just want to do what I do, you know? I'm not looking for validation, you know, from people. I don't, you know, because here's the thing, at a certain age, things change anyway. The new wealth is health. You start thinking about total different things. You're not even worried about the things that you used to worry about. So, you know, I just be you and live your best life. So whatever that
talk is. About it, I am me. Just be you.
Yeah, just be you. You know?
Right. See, and what all these men are saying is they're secure in their solidarity. They're secure within themselves. And unfortunately, a lot of those masculine tough guys ain't secure. Because I can tell you, when I first got to college at Delaware State, dudes was talking about finding other dudes to hang with. I'm like, dude, I'm going to the female dorm. Y'all can hang with each other. That's not the game I'm playing. Because they couldn't roll by themselves. They couldn't move by themselves. Now, I got in some situations because I was by myself. You know what I mean? But I'm like, hey, that's money that can go. Long as my health is good, I'll make more money. You know what I mean? But I don't need 30 people around me. That's an insecure person, in my opinion.
You know what's valuable to me now? Go ahead.
No, you go ahead. I'm a gentleman.
You know what's valuable? Peace of mind. Peace of mind. Mental health is important. Like, I'm trying to tell you. I when I look at the music, the acting, whatever it is, you know, we don't have 100 years on this earth. Some of us don't have tomorrow. We don't know. Yep. So regardless, like I could give out 12,000 roses right there, right now, and don't you know about 1,000 women would still be mad because a thorn was in one of them. You understand? You can't worry about what people, you know, think, because people go feel what they feel. But that peace of mind is important.
So let me shift. In a man's mind, who comes first, his wife or his mother?
My wife.
When I have my one, wife. My wife.
Okay. What is this mentality of men saying, my mom will always be my mama? What is that mentality?
Little boys.
That's a little boy mentality that they want us to keep having.
Okay. Interesting.
No, at 18, when I told my mother I wasn't coming back. Mm-hmm. And when I got married, my mother had to leave my house because my mother ended up moving in with me because she got divorced. Okay. So, yeah. So it's like when it was time to get married, mom, you got to go. You know, now when she gets older and she may need me, then of course I'll be there. But physically, no, she was still young. My mother just turning 60 something. So she's still kicking. She's still healthy. So no, you got to go out there and fend for yourself now. Mm-hmm. But no, the wife, you come first.
So let me ask always. This, and I don't necessarily know every, did you have something to say, Lo?
No, I'm saying always. I said when I get, you know, right now it's still like, you know, we dating and everything, we good, but like if something happened to where it's between her and my mom, it's kind of hard enough because I ain't married. We just dating, but you know, still that's my mom, you know, but at the same point, you got to check for who's checking for you every day too. So mm-hmm. That's what helps you get centered. Is really it's hard to answer that question. Being real with who's checking for you.
Of course, I would say my wife when I was married, but it's hard to say that if you lost your mom. You know what I mean? Because mm-hmm. when you get a little older, you know, I lost my mom was 52. And there are a lot of things I would have done differently. You know, I was married, you know, and my mom was dealing with a drug addiction at the time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, certain things I would have done differently because I had to choose wife.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's circumstances too.
Yeah,
you know what I mean, like that's a tough situation, man. Like that addiction thing is tough.
You know, because you love. I mean, the love a boy has for his mother is, and then when you throw in that dynamic, so then when you throw in you're married too. You know, it can be rough because now hindsight, you know, my mom gone. I'm like, wow, the things that I understand now that she went through as a single mother. You know, now that you're old, I say, oh, I understand she was depressed. That's why she was doing that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But, it depends on the situation.
Does compassion replace devotion? You understand what I mean? Like being devoted husband, does the compassion you have for, you know, a mom or a parent going through something replace the devotion of, you know, this day to become one? Do you understand what I'm asking?
Yeah. Knowing what I know now.
I mean, because clearly you got divorced though. You know what I mean?
Well, no, I had a good wife though. She was a good wife. She was a really good woman, you know? But no, still, you can't get your mama back.
Right.
And my wife and I would have had a few more arguments. Just put it that way.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
And then nothing wrong with that.
Yeah,
it makes the world go round. Differences of opinion and perspectives. Yeah. You know, everybody has their own journey. You know, nobody knows your relationship like you do.
Char, once they lower your mother down in that box, and you know you walk away from that cemetery, you're not going to see her again. Mm-hmm. It's a whole different ball game. Life is just totally different. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And to choose love. That you don't know what could happen
mm-hmm.
over the love for your mom. That's deep. I mean, it's
over your foundation. I got you.
Yeah, my God.
So let me ask this, because I've asked this a couple of times on here, but I'm always interested in the responses. You know, on social media and our society, people always say, you know, a boy needs a father. A boy needs a father. My question is, and a lot of women, I'm the mother and the father, and I don't necessarily believe that, but you know, that seems, no, you're not. What you are is a person raising a nice person.
Yeah,
you know?
You're a woman,
but,
right.
What is the role? What is the undeniable thing that fathers instill primarily in their sons, but in their children, daughters and sons, you know, because I don't know if, I can't remember if everybody has kids or not. I know Darnerien does, but what is the role, you know, or what was instilled in you, you know, that was paramount from a father or a male figure or something like that?
Wisdom.
Okay, go ahead.
Wisdom was the main thing, how to navigate through life. And I didn't have a father. You know, I just buried my father 3 months ago, my biological father, but I had uncles and godfathers around, you know, but that wisdom and how to navigate, how to handle things.
As a man.
You know, yeah, as a man. You know what I mean? Like, and there's certain things you should know. There's certain things that a young Black boy need to know. I mean, this show not long enough to go through them all, but I'm just saying it's a lot.
I've been told observing. Like, it can't be necessarily quantified or, you know, pinpointed all the time, but observing the behaviors of how the influential men in your life influence your perspective on life and how you move. Is that
exactly?
I spent the last couple of decades deprogramming myself from what I learned. So it's like,
okay, in your case, you want to deprogram yourself.
Yeah, I had to deprogram myself because, you know, it's a different world. There's different worlds out there. And if we just start remembering that when we deal with each other and just try to meet each other where we are instead of where we think you're supposed to come from, I think a lot of conversations will be a lot more smooth.
So did you personally have to deprogram yourself because it wasn't a favorable relationship with the father or the men in your life or whatever? Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
Bad examples, things of that nature, and activity I was doing and things of that nature. So I had to get all that changed. So
see, in my circumstances was that early. So I deprogrammed myself early. So for me, I observed what I liked and what I didn't like. So I had a stepfather who worked. I only seen him on the weekends. He went to work at 8 o'clock, came back at 8 o'clock. And he might have went to work for then, because I think he went to work before he went to school. So he was kind of just with us on the weekends. He basically provided, far as from my perspective. Mm-hmm. And I had my biological father. From my perspective, he intelligent hoodlum. So, you know what I mean? Like, he gave me the truth. I can tell you the one thing about I love about my biological father is he always told me the truth, no matter what he was going through or what he was doing. Mm-hmm. And so I seen it because he grew up in Baltimore City. You know, through the 60s and 70s. And then my best friend's father, who was the intellect, the Afro-American, the pro-Black guy. And I'm like, okay, you know, and I took all three of them and whatever else, you know, I would see. And I'm like, okay. And I know I wasn't strong enough to go to jail. I wasn't strong enough to run the streets. I wasn't strong enough to go to military. So I was like, in order for me to survive, I got to use this noodle. You know, so I would sit and observe, you know, like I said, going in and out of jail, different family members, you know, running the streets, the drugs, you know, especially during the 80s and the crack epidemic, everybody was involved to an extent at some point. And I'm like, I'm not built like them. Even though I was from Baltimore, I wasn't built like them. They always called me country, even when I was little. It was like, I just, for whatever reason, I was just different. And I knew in order for me to survive, I had to use more of my head than actually my physical ability. Lo and behold, I became 6'4". But as I grew up, I was always the smallest and I was always the youngest. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, I can't do this because it's not going to work for me. So I had to, like I said, I had to be observant of those masculine roles early.
Right. Yeah. One of the viewers said, I think he's talking about what fathers bring, emotional intelligence, is what he said.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's true.
For anybody who has a boy and a girl, like, I have brothers and sisters. But it's way different having your own children. Like, when they say women are from Venus and boys from Mars, oh my goodness, that's like the truth. But it's a different intelligence. So like I said, certain things I'm doing that my son will tell me I did when he gets older and be able to articulate, we can sit down and have a conversation that I don't know that I'm doing just because I'm a male. And like my mother, for the most part, raised me. She would tell me, it's certain things I can't teach you. You have to, and you're going to have to figure certain things out on your own. Mm-hmm. So like I said, certain nature and natural things that we do, we can't teach, but the child will observe because we learn directly and indirectly.
Mm-hmm. So I don't think I've asked this question. If I have, it's been a while. And this is one of my more introspective shows, but I think it's necessary to hear uncut what men think and the mind of a man, because women constantly say, men don't talk. Men, I bet you they do. As 145 men say they do, because I've had them on this platform. So, but my question is, how do men handle trauma and disappointments and heartache and the pains of life? You know, and I'm let me preface this question. There's someone very close to me that I've known all my life, I'll put it that way. And maybe a month or two ago, they just dropped a whammy on me of something traumatic that they've been dealing with their entire life and never said anything. And I was like, where did you store that? You know what I mean? And it made some things make sense. So I'm asking, how do men handle trauma and the pains of life and heartache and all the things that happen just because we're human, but how do men handle it?
I'm gonna say we. Yeah. Go ahead, bro.
That's on you. Go ahead, bro.
No, what I was going to say is, from my perspective and observations, we hold everything in because we have to be strong. We have to be tough. We can't show any kind of fear. We can't be human. We have been dehumanized as Black men. Because if I cry in front of you, oh, he weak. You know what I mean? If I show any kind of emotion, something's wrong. Why are you doing that? So, and then as far as communication, I am a talker. But if you ain't listening, what am I talking for? If we're supposed to be having a conversation and you're just telling me your perspective, me, I'm gonna stop talking. Right. And that's why you see older couples when they get married, he over there, she over there. We ain't got nothing to talk about because you weren't listening from the beginning. Because unfortunately, we pedestal our women in some situations and don't see them as equal, or they don't see us as equals, where we can give each other information and not agree. It's like a debate. I don't have to agree with you. You're a Republican, I'm a Democrat. We're going to debate, but you have your stance, I have my stance. That don't mean we don't like each other. I don't have to, you know, dislike you. But from my perspective, like I said, we have to hold all that in. And that's why, you know, looking at my friends now, we're dying of heart attacks. I had over 10 plus teammates this past 2 years die from heart diseases. We're under 40, 30, 40. And I'm like, then the other half of them, like with the NFL, they say most of them die 50, 55. That's just called being a Black male with the stress you got to live with every day. And then plus when you got the stress, when you got to come home and deal with your kids and everything else that come with it.
Yeah. Lo, did you want to say something?
Right on, brother.
He really covered it.
Okay. he did. That's why, yeah. I was like, you know.
Yeah, like he said a mouthful for real. And man, yeah.
You know, it all depends on the situation too, you know, and the individual. You know, I'm an extrovert sometimes, mm-hmm. but mainly I'm an introvert. You know, I like to communicate though. I like to talk, and thank God I have certain, you know, friends and family around I can talk to about certain things. But I'm more so I talk about mine because mm-hmm. I go nuts.
Yeah,
you know, I go nuts. You know, so everybody is different, and it depends on the trauma. Mm-hmm. Depends on what that trauma is.
Right.
It also depends on your support circle, because if your support circle is like, that is weak, then you're not gonna, if your support your support circle is dysfunctional, you're gonna have dysfunction. You're gonna handle everything dysfunctional. So mm-hmm. it's really about who you're around, because before I couldn't really talk about stuff. I would keep it in all the time and then it would erupt. You know, so you have to learn how to let that pressure valve out. But as a Black man, we have been dehumanized. So certain things, it's almost like if you say something to someone or you share, you become vulnerable, they'll use that as a weapon. They'll weaponize it these days. So you really have to be careful who you trust with certain things about you, because it could be weaponized later.
Right.
In this social media age that we live in. So there's that aspect of it as well too. And it's like everybody's trying to act like they're so knowledgeable about emotions and how to deal with them, but they're really not. They're just trying to get likes or, you know, stuff like that. or just right. really just get the perspective out, but they're just they're listening to reply but not listening to understand, so we can get together and get this healing going on.
Right. So. I really do think there's power in listening, you know, to understand, to, you know, embrace, and not listening to speak next, you know, and sometimes that's missing. And I think, I don't know why it's missing, but I will ask my final question on every show as we're closing in on 9 o'clock. And it is, what is something you wish women knew or understood about men?
Simple.
You said that you're simple?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me what it is. Don't tell me what you think I want to hear. Tell me what it is.
Right. See, but that's the disconnect, between, like I said, between women and men. Women are complex. Men are simple.
Yeah.
What's wrong with you? Nothing. Something's wrong with you. You came in and you didn't say anything, or you didn't do this and you sat down. I'm tired. I just want to sit down. Like, okay. who are you texting? What is it? Oh, I'm texting. I'm watching highlights of football. Like, a lot of times women dig too deep for absolutely no reason. Like, we're that airheaded and that simple. We're like,
we don't read minds. We can't do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You gotta tell us.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I thought you thought what? I wouldn't think about nothing.
Yeah, it's like the more we assume, the more we become consumed in our own crap, you know. So we got to really just stop assuming this, really open up that level of conversation.
Yeah, and like I say, we're more logical. So, you know, I think that's the balance also. So women are more emotional, men are more logical, but super sensitive from what I've seen. So like, you hurt a man, he'll be hurt for years. You hurt a woman, she cry about it, tell her friends, and then she ready to move on.
That's the point there.
Did you have something to close out, Richard?
I agree with the two brothers, you know. they hit it right on the point. I mean, they hit it on the nose, you know.
Yeah,
We as men, we hurt too. Mm-hmm. We hurt.
Okay.
We have trauma we deal with. And I think a lot of us have trauma that we deal with.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us are more vocal about it, you know, and some are not, you know. Just understand we're all just human, you know?
Right.
Nice.
I this is just a bonus question, but I was listening to your responses. Can you really deal with a male-minded woman or a woman who's not as emotional as you're used to or who is logical? Or is that off-putting? Do you like the yin-yang and the confusion, the ball of confusion that makes relationships go around? So,
not at this age.
I'm scared about this age.
I'm scared a woman gonna give me a stroke.
See, my biggest thing is the main thing I love about my lady is she gets me. I ain't gotta explain nothing. You know, and I don't have to do a whole lot of deciphering with her. It's like communication is good, you know, so it takes time. It takes practice to do that. You don't get there overnight. You just got to be patient with each other and really mean what you say and stand on what you say. And let your yays be yay and your nays be nay. I think that'll make things go a lot smoother.
I'm going to stay married to this music. And this is going to be my girlfriend for at least the next 6 months.
Oh, okay. I was going to say 6 years at least. Okay, that's a short relationship.
No, I'm telling you, you know, you get to a point. See, it's not about how fat she is, how fine she is. You need a woman that know the signs of a stroke.
I can't stand you.
That is the truth.
Hey.
Go get my medicine. You know what I'm
saying? You silly as hell.
A friend of mine, he was a millionaire. He was an executive. He was a millionaire.
Oh, man.
He had a mansion out upper Marlboro. He went and met this young girl, and they got in an argument, and he tried to keep up with her arguing, and he had a stroke right in the middle of the argument. And you know where he is now? He's in hospice.
Oh, he's in hospice? Okay.
Oh, man, that's not funny.
Not funny.
He's silly, but it's not funny, but it's true.
Yeah. Get me one of those masseuse. You know, one of the women that's into the earth and into massages and yoga. Something that's peaceful.
Ladies and gentlemen, Richard Burton.
Hey, that's the best one. That's the best one. Hey, like, I see a woman. Who knows the size of this? Hey, because that's perfect stand-up right there. That's punchline. Comment.
No, I heard that somewhere right before, somewhere. I think Sinbad, somebody said a long time ago, but it's true.
Either Sinbad or Earthquake. I heard it before, too.
Yeah, one of them said it, but it's true.
Yeah.
Yes.
I want to say it was Earthquake. I'm gonna find it because I'm a big comedian connoisseur. So yeah, I've heard it before, but your timing was perfect. Like, I need somebody to know the size of a stroke.
That was I think that was DC Curry.
Was it Curry?
Well, they all must be saying the same joke then.
They probably pass around that punchline because
I've heard one of them say something like that before.
Yeah, it's kind of, I know we didn't get you the relationship part,
but they already have somebody, so you know it's probably hard for them to talk about.
Well, I try to pick and choose what I talk about every week, and I really do book the guests. You know, I really do give some thought into the combination.
I got you.
And so we did talk about it, though. You know, we talked about the other side of relationships and what men think and how they're processing trauma. And that has to do with relationships, whether people want to admit it or not, because how you get out of a relationship has everything to do with what you've been through.
We got to have a part two one day.
Absolutely. I definitely want to meet up again. I like the way y'all think, brothers.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys.
The Erica Badu joint, bag lady.
Oh, Lord.
My takeaways tonight were that, you know, men reemphasize that they are simplistic, and also sometimes women want there to be more than what there is, and you know, on the surface. I mean, I found that, you know, building a career, talking to men, and you know, managing careers, and 99% of my clients have been men over the past 26 years. You know, they mean what they say for the most part, but they meant what they said, not what you thought you heard, not what you wanted to hear 6 months later, but what they said. They meant that part. You know, initially what they said, they meant that. No matter what happened next. Yep. You know, and I said this before on the show, even if he says, I want to be friends, and you so graciously offer him a piece of vagina, and he, and you're like, we must be more than friends now. He's still your friend, sweetie. He's still your friend.
Nowadays, it's different now, Char, out here. It's different. You have sex with a girl, y'all go together.
In her mind.
Yeah, well, that's
exactly what, that's what I said. So he still go together day one.
Well, I'm gonna say this. The word relationship, the root word to that is relate. A lot of people out here trying to get together, they ain't relating on jack, and that's why their relationship is not happening. Find somebody to relate with, and don't worry about what everybody else thinks. As long as you two relate, forget the world. Can't cuss, so I know I was gonna stop by something else.
The guys always tell me they get 3 cuss words a show. I was like, oh, okay. So they do it anyway. They set their own rules.
I'm honor the queen of the room. We'll do that.
I appreciate you. I'd like to share it. You know, language doesn't bother me at all. But
you got other platforms you might be putting this on, so you want
to
make sure.
But you know what? I like to show, one, that men do talk, and they are able to communicate exactly what they're thinking. And Absolutely. Two, they're able to do it succinctly and intelligently and in a way that you can understand without you getting excuse. I was listening to these said book. You know? And say, no, you weren't. You weren't listening. So I don't want them to have an excuse not to hear what's being said. So I'm honoring men in trying to create a platform where they say, mean what they say, and say it uncut, but say it in a clear, concise way where there's no excuses for not listening. You know what I mean? So I wanted, we just crossed the 1-year mark of shows. And so I'm so thankful that you all have been rocking with me. Thank you for a year. And I want to thank my guest tonight, Richard Burton, ThatDamnLo, and Coach Darnerien McCants. And I also want to thank my squad, my producer, Corey Marshall, helps with my clubhouse rooms and keeps me motivated and pushing forward. He's like, whatever you do, don't give up. So that's the biggest thing he ever said to me this year. But and one of my besties, Tony Rock, and my brother, Rodney Prey, they support me unconditionally. And they talk about this platform on stage, off stage, on their platform. So I appreciate them. And season three, we have been heating up. We started off with the Plastic Cup Boys, Kevin Hart's the Plastic Cup Boys. And as of tonight, we've had 145 men on my platform. And so I am so thankful that you all honored me with your presence and your support. And you said yes when I called. And so thank you, gentlemen. And we've had everybody from Cisco, D-Ray Davis, Rip Michaels, Ryan Davis, George Wallace. We've had a whole bunch of people on here. Mike Hill from Real Housewives of Atlanta. They've been coming through. And so check out the past episodes on Char-Town Entertainment. Please like, share, and subscribe to my platforms and my pages. I appreciate you guys. Check me out on Thursday and Friday nights, my other platform, after my best-selling book, Just One Thing, foreword by Mike Epps. And I talk about one-on-one relationships, one-on-one conversations about life and life-changing moments, life-defining moments.
About halfway through it, I got my copy.
Oh, thank you, love. I appreciate it. And so, I'll see you next Thursday. Next Tuesday, I'm all over the place. Next Tuesday, October 12th, that will be my 50th episode. So we're going to have some good ones coming through. Thank these gentlemen. I've had such amazing guests throughout all of these shows, all 49 of them, and I'm honored and grateful. I'm Sherman McMillan. It is what it is, how men think. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
All right, y'all have a blessed night.
All right, your own brand of beautiful. All right, much love.
All right, fellas, nice to meet you.
All right,
nice to meet y'all, fellas, for sure.
For sure. We'll see each other again soon. Much love.
No doubt.
Okay, bye-bye.